I'm really excited we got a chance to talk to Ibrahim AlHusseini. Ibrahim is a really noted investor in the climate space, and he's thought really hard about how we have to deploy capital in order to solve some of our biggest climate problems.
Well, hey, well, thank you for joining us today. I really appreciate you coming to share some perspectives about how the investment world thinks about climate solutions. What kind of worries you about climate change? Where are some of the big concerns, some of the big worries that keep you up at night a little bit about this big issue?
So I guess my biggest concern is the fact that the asset allocators in the world have not yet developed new boxes that they feel they need to check to deploy capital into this space. You know, we're still operating from an old model of strictly chasing yield, which is a little futile, on a kind of planet that's becoming destabilized through climate, right? Because, obviously civilization is built on a stable climate and the economy is part of modern civilization. So when that piece starts wobbling, it creates risk to our entire portfolio. So we need to hurry up and start creating new boxes that fit these new models that are designed specifically to condense the rollout of climate critical technologies as fast as possible. And obviously, this idea of politics playing a role in, and thwarting putting a price on carbon, which will immediately, start shifting all our economy to a more sustainable one, has been thwarting us a little bit, right? Because it's, unfortunately, the way democracies work isn't about what we need the most. It's about what a politician can sell based on what people's current awareness and understanding is. So we end up with, politicians who are pushing off critical legislation like putting a price on carbon and, for something, let's say, more voter friendly, like prolonging some fossil fuel infrastructure that has certain jobs in certain valuable voting districts, which, end up maybe winning an election, but end up hurting all of humanity, including the nation that that person gets voted in to lead in the first place.
Yeah, it's a very interesting. It can get cynical pretty fast when you think like the market really isn't a free market. There's a political economy. There are people with their thumb on the scale that weigh towards certain industries, certain kinds of investments. And that may be for political expediency, as you're saying, or the interest of some very powerful people behind the politicians who are funneling the money and tools to keep elected.
And can I speak to that for a second?
Sure, yeah, please.
So it's interesting. So I'm an investor in renewable, sustainable infrastructure, and I've developed a model that accelerates the deployment of climate critical technologies. My partners and I have been doing this since 2013, and I came to that model really just by being a clean tech investor since 2003. And I came to that by being a scuba diver and seeing the degradation of the quality of the marine life firsthand and realizing there's no point becoming wealthier on a planet that's dying. That seemed like an exercise in futility. So, so I hear a lot of pushback around, hey, let the free market solve the problem. And I'm down. I'm happy to compete in a free market. But like you just said, it's not a free market. There's a fossil fuel infrastructure in the United States has a specific designation in the tax code that allows them to create structures called master limited partnerships that are partnerships that can IPO, that can go public. So that means they're a single layer taxation where a corporation has to pay taxes at the corporate level and on the distributions that the individuals or investment firms get. So that one has a double taxation, one has a single taxation, and these are designated specifically for certain verticals. So this notion that we're a free market-driven economy, like you said, is false. And yes, politicians say it because it wins them.
It sounds great.
it creates an illusion in the electorate that it's actually true, but it literally is a lie. We are not a free market system. We're not a completely market-based economy.
Yeah, that's Well, I agree completely, and I think sometimes environmentalists will just, you know, poke at like, oh, capitalism is broken. I'm like, well, this form of it is, because it's not actually the markets solving the problem. Markets are sometimes very good at solving problems, but not when you put your thumb on the scale. It's pretty hard to change it when the rules aren't fair, and maybe we need new kinds of rules. But yeah, so that's kind of the problem of where we are today, I guess. That's such good points. But you also look at a lot of opportunities for making the world better in terms of, you know, more renewable and kind of more, you know, regenerative, if you will, or, you know, just best, you know, more sustainable kinds of opportunities. And you're looking for opportunities to invest in them that can scale and can be transformative. What gets you excited these days? What are some of the things that excite you the most about the future opportunities?
Sure. So, you know, so like I said earlier, we developed a specific, very nuanced model to combating climate change from the private sector through aggregating investment capital and, you know, and delivering it, deploying it inside of a specific thesis that I'm going to share with you that I think you'll just be excited to know that it exists. Well, our first criteria for the technologies is that they're market ready, meaning that they're, you know, they're not in early stages of development, because most people don't realize as sexy as a lot of these, you know, futuristic technologies sound, it'll take decades till they're commercialized. And we're already decades late to solving the problem. So we need market-ready technologies. You know, the analogy I give sometimes is that if there's a fire in your backyard, you don't go invent firefighting technology, you grab fire hoses and buckets.
That's a great analogy. I'm going to borrow that if you don't mind.
Yeah. So that's the first thing we do. The second thing we look for is we look for what we call climate critical technology. And the threshold for critical for us is technologies that can abate a minimum of 1 gigaton or more of CO2 or CO2 equivalent at full deployment. The discrepancy between what civilization generates and what the Earth can absorb is about 42 gigatons. And every one of our technologies has to be responsible for at least a gigaton or more of that discrepancy. And the way we get there, interestingly enough, is not by focusing on CO2, is by focusing on the other greenhouse gases that are very rarely spoken of. Because even though these short-lived climate pollutants, which is again a misnomer because they just break down into CO2 anyway, things like methane and nitrous oxide and refrigerants, they make up 24% of atmospheric greenhouse gases, but are responsible for close to 50% of the warming. So if we focus on those, find out where in the economy they're being emitted, and solve for those in a risk-adjusted return, then we're getting the highest carbon return on investment we can, as well as producing really attractive risk-adjusted returns for our investors. And, you know, and another way we speed up the process after finding these types of technologies is by standardizing their offering, kind of turning them into a franchise for, you know, for simplicity, and becoming their master franchisee, where we're stamping out their technology all over the world as fast as possible by investing in the equity of the companies and into their projects for up to $1 billion each until they become an obvious solution to that vertical. And then the market can just take them the rest of the way there.
That's really crucial. There's some very, very clever things that you just said that actually speak to some of what I just talked about in my little lecture on greenhouse gases too. First is, you know, hey, now is better than new when it comes to technology. Because, and I love your analogy, like if your house is on fire, you don't invent a hose. You use the damn hose you've got already because you've wasted too much time. And we've wasted 40 years trying. And we actually have invented some good technology. Solar panels started at Bell Labs in the 1950s, then NASA. Now they're ready. But we can't wait 70 years for the next technology because, you know, there won't be a lot of planet left. So, you know, R&D is important, but it's about bringing it to scale. The other thing I loved about what you said, too, a lot of things I loved, but in other words, focusing on more than just CO2. CO2 should get a lot of the focus. It's the single biggest greenhouse gas, of course. But you look at all the others, methane, N2O, the fluorinated gases, even the other weird super pollutants, they carry a lot of bang for their buck. And sometimes they have kind of very, very focused sources. There's a lot of 80-20 rules. When it comes to N2O, for example, most of it's emitted in a few key places in the economy, or methane or fluorinated gases. That's a very specific emission source. And so a little bit of money there, when still considerable investment, but has a disproportionate return. And we sometimes kind of forget about that. It's a bigger chessboard than just the CO2 from energy. We got to look at all of it. And
and there's an added health benefit. You know, I mean, like 25% of the children in Delhi grow up with respiratory illness because they are breathing nitrous oxide every day. You know, our bodies are used to breathing CO2. So, but you know, they will not do well and not develop well breathing a lot of these short-lived climate pollutants. So there's that added health benefit as well by focusing on those areas, not ignoring CO2 at all. I'm just saying that there's a, you know, there's a lot more, like you said, bang for the buck in that other area.
There are families of these chemicals together that, yeah, when we solve for one, we have multiple co-benefits as well. And at least from the agricultural sources of N2O pollution, you're also usually, if you go back to the farmer's fields and say, let's use less fertilizer, be more efficient in agriculture, which is one of the biggest sources, you often get benefits to water quality too, because that nitrogen right. can also become nitrate in drinking water and in rivers and ultimately into the coastal oceans, causing dead zones in the ocean. A lot of people don't see that connection from the farmer's field to climate change above, but to a dead zone downstream. And a lot of it's because we incentivize too much fertilizers and manures on farmers' fields, especially in India, China, and the United States. About 2/3 of all the nitrate pollution in the world comes from those three countries. So that's really important, and very, you know, 80-20 kind of rule of like, here's where the biggest problem is per buck. Really crucial. And I love your idea of like taking, you know, get to the economy of scale, I guess. I'm not sure if that's quite what you were saying, but kind of to the franchise model. Like, if you put enough capital in, then suddenly you get to another kind of regime of business scale where things can be more quickly adopted. It isn't just a one-off company here, a little one-off there. Suddenly they become, you know, they leverage the power of being big. And that's really crucial. So it sounds like a really neat kind of set of investment principles. How's it working? Do you see some really good impact so far, and good returns and good impact?
So far, it's been working great. And the best thing that I can share is that the funding market, the capital markets are starting to pay attention. You know, I've had the most interesting conversations with some institutions lately that they themselves came and led with saying, hey, you know, we're ready to throw out the existing boxes that we've been required to check and create new boxes to solve the problems of today instead of just generating the returns of yesterday. And I'm so glad that that's the case, because that's been really the biggest bottleneck. Technologies are ready. You know, there's enough entrepreneurs and fund managers that are ready. It's just that the capital markets have been very slow on changing. They have these existing legacy issues that, you know, are blockers that they pay too much attention to, given the risk associated with, you know, not actually deploying that capital.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to, you know, what is it? CMA. There's a CMA policy. Well, you know, the biggest CMA policy is make sure that, you know, the life support system of the only planet we could inhabit continues to maintain itself. And so finally, we're at that point. I think COVID might have helped a lot, because obviously you mentioned connectivity and how everything's connected. You know, an individual coughs in a wet market halfway across the world and the entire planet shuts down less than a year later. So that tells us that there is no lane for economy and lane for climate and lane for health. It's all inextricably connected, and we have to think of it all as one biosphere and one ecosystem. And, you know, that nitrate, or, you know, those chemicals are going to create other problems. It's the butterfly effect everywhere all the time. It's just how delayed is the consequence.
Yeah, well, you mentioned the COVID pandemic too, and that's another lesson. And you know, it has so much an analogy to climate change, because scientists have been warning us about that for 30 to 40 years as well, saying, hey, bad forms of agriculture, like, you know, bushmeat trade with no oversight or regulation, or confined animal agriculture at a scale unseen in human history, next to billions of people living in cities with no oversight, no regulation. And these are breeding grounds for new viruses and new kinds of microbial agents that are getting unleashed. 80% of the new diseases coming into humanity are what we call zoonotic, or meaning originally from an animal. And so some of the things we need to do to kind of fix kind of the, you know, agriculture and land use and other things for the next pandemic, actually, some of those are related to the solutions for climate change too. like, hey, let's not tear down rainforests where there are novel viruses running around in wild animals and like eating them. Maybe leave those alone for a while. Let's kind of let the bats and the other animals stay put. And maybe animal agriculture needs to be rethought to be a little bit different scale than it is today, both for a climate point of view, but the next disease point of view as well. I hope capital markets are paying attention to that because they get a big wake-up call that, like you said, a virus halfway across the world can shut down the global economy. And that's the least of the impact. I mean, people, you know, there'll be a million people dead from this damn thing before we're done or more. And just the human call, you know, toll of that is incredible. So I hope we learn. You know,
I mean, think about, let's say that, you know, COVID was a black swan event, you know, but if we went back to, you know, 2019 and told every investor in the world what was going to happen in 2020, that what they would have done with their capital would have been completely different. What they would have invested in, what they would have divested out of, that would have made they would have adjusted their portfolio completely. Interestingly enough, climate change we know is happening and we know the consequences. So we have the chance to do something about it. It's not just going to appear, it is appearing and will continue to intensify. So this is the time to make those adjustments in the first place. So I think obviously inertia is one of our biggest enemies. But I think the cost from COVID has woken people's eyes up to, wait a second, you know, like we are part of nature. So nature is going to have its effect on us and every way we interact with the world. So we need to make adjustments to our investment portfolios accordingly.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, again, I'm not an investor, but just what you hear from folks in your community. So, you know, it's about the risk adjusted rates of return on capital. Like, okay, I'm a simple minded guy, but I'm like, hey, you know, the risk you're thinking about, throw out the history books because everything you know is wrong. Climate change represents an entirely different planet. And the longer we make it, you know, not stop, the worse and riskier it's just going to get. And then you add like pandemics and other things. And you know, you mentioned black swans. We're going to have whole, you know, flocks of them hitting us pretty soon. And so that's going to be a real problem too. And but also the opportunity landscape too is like, you know, hey, wait a minute, solving this problem may be one of the better investment opportunities in history. If we can get the politicians to take their thumbs off the scale and have a more level playing field, like, destroying the planet turns out to be a really bad business plan. You know, maybe it's a better business plan to de-risk the planet and look for opportunities for a 21st and 22nd century economy, not a 19th century economy perpetuating itself because people resist change, tooth and nail, because they're making a little bit more money today.
I was just saying, like, you know, for the next 50 and 100 years, we are going to replace all the existing infrastructure that underpins modern civilization, our water systems, our energy systems, our transportation system, our food systems. All of that is going to be changed. So you're accurate when you say it's the biggest investment opportunity in human history, because everything that the world runs on today is 19th and 20th century technologies that are, you know, less efficient and were never designed to reconcile the chemical balance on the planet. They were just so novel at the time that nobody thought that, hey, we live in a closed sphere in the middle of space and we have a chemical balance that has to reconcile itself every year, or else we end up with a chemical imbalance that creates warming, toxicity, and all kinds of stuff eventually. And that day has come, the math has caught up with us. So here we are, you know, having to, you know, upgrade our infrastructure, which is great. So we actually have a chance, if we can accelerate it fast enough, it's really just a matter of acceleration. If we can deploy enough capital fast enough, I mean, not only do we make a fantastic risk-adjusted return, but we also get the added benefit of living in a world where the air is cleaner, the water's cleaner, there's no, you know, people can grow food where they are, they don't have to migrate by the hundreds of millions and create geopolitical instability in other places. You know, the parts of the world that we have billions of people living in them today remain inhabitable, don't become uninhabitable and create all kinds of wars. I mean, it's a very, you know, we have a chance to look at this time and go, wow, we averted the biggest destabilizing crisis in human history, or we had a chance to avert it, and we decided, you know what, that, you know, pop brownie delivery drone company looked really attractive, so we went ahead and invested in that instead. All of the stuff is great, but we have a foundational issue now. We have to take a step back and reinforce the foundation of which all of this fantastic futuristic reality lives on, because we're not going to enjoy it anyway. Like, we're not going to enjoy it if the world is, you know, geopolitically, health and climate destabilized.
That's really well said. It's that's one of the things that frustrates me sometimes about, like, how environmentalists talk about the economy and capitalism. It's absolutely fair to be very skeptical of modern day capitalism, as we call it. But sometimes I say, wait a minute, I don't think this is capitalism. I think this is profiteering. This is people just looking for a quick win without thinking about the future at all. A real capitalist, if I got my history right, would be saying, you know, a wealthier people would be people who have people who are not destabilized, where there isn't chaos. There are more trees than there were before. The fish are more numerous. We have more water. And we have more educated, healthier people. That's what I think a real capitalism could be, is looking at the human and natural, as well as financial and social capital, and say we should build them all up and be stewards of that and make sure it's not put at risk to just all be blown because of a disaster. So I find it a little frustrating that we criticize capitalism, but I think we're mislabeling it. It's like, these are profiteering jerks who've hijacked the system, bent the rules to satisfy them in the short run, and screwing everybody in the long run. And, you know, that's not what we have to do. Maybe we could use the power of capital markets to, you know, with more oversight, better policy, a little more wisdom, and less hubris than maybe today. But I think what you're describing is an opportunity for capital to flow in good directions that are better for people, and let markets solve problems what they're good at, but we still need good policy and we need better culture.
And we need fair taxation. One of the ways that, you know, capitalism also gets a bad rap is that, you know, the jerks that you're talking about, you know, put a lot of undue pressure on, you know, through lobbying and through, you know, dark money campaigning to create unfair, unjust taxation that benefits them at the cost of society. And I attest that none of us win unless we all win. So this notion that it's a zero sum game and, like, you know, I'm gonna go grab mine and go hide somewhere, there is no place to hide. There is no away on a closed sphere in the middle of space. It's a tiny planet. Pollution doesn't stop at borders. Like, those days are over. I think these are legacy thinking, legacy cultures from a time where, you know, we all were relatively poor and people were dying of starvation. So we're still in this hoarding mentality, this scarcity mentality. And I think that is over. Like, I think 50% of the population today of the world is middle class. So, you know, we're getting to a point where, you know, we do live in a more abundant existence. So our laws, our taxations, our thinking, our culture has to incorporate that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a very different world in so many other ways. I mean, the truly scary part of all this is, you know, our policy instruments, our financial tools, our way of managing capital, kind of, you know, how we govern ourselves isn't keeping up with our technology or the pace of change on the planet. We're still thinking like it's the 19th century, but the 21st century is moving along very quickly, especially in technological change and out there on the real planet in terms of climate change is happening a little faster than maybe we thought. And it's catching up with us, as you say. And the last question I have for you too is, like, what's next? So you're presenting some, you know, there are risks to kind of how we think about investing in capital that are very real, becoming more apparent. There's some great opportunities and strategies emerging to identify which opportunities might be really impactful in the near term and long term. What's next to kind of take this bigger? We've got a lot of work to do. How do we get this even to go faster?
So, you know, the first thing we have to do is we have to vote for candidates who are climate positive. You know, we still are dealing with candidates that are denying climate change as if it's something to believe in. I mean, I just saw this funny internet meme that says, you know, I don't know if you've seen it, says something like, you know, stop asking people if they believe in climate change. ask them if they understand climate change. It's not Santa Claus.
Yeah.
So, you know, we need to vote for candidates that understand climate change and understand that investing in this area of greening the economy is going to create tens of millions of jobs that are completely resilient and high paying, jobs that are not going to disappear with AI and robotics. So they are the future. You know, we're going to benefit, our healthcare costs are going to go down because we're not breathing toxic air, we're not drinking toxic water, you know. And, you know, the next thing we have to do is we just have to look at, you know, look at where we're allocating capital and look at the criteria of which we allocate capital to and see if they're dated. See if we're still operating from a, you know, from a asset allocator standpoint with the rules of yesteryear that say, oh, well, I don't do first time funds. Well, there isn't such a thing as a second time climate fund, you know. This is a new thing. So we're never going to get there if that's one of the criterias. Oh, hey, we don't do, you know, a mingled asset fund. Well, that's the model that's going to accelerate the deployment of climate critical technologies. So, and that gives nice diversification. So there's all of these kind of legacy ways that we think that I'm heartened that some investors are starting to understand and starting to ask the right questions and have the right conversations. We just need to move from the conversations to the allocations, because there's so many fantastic entrepreneurs and fund managers who have real solutions, who just need more assets at their disposal that they can deploy into the right areas and create a virtual cycle for all of us.
Yeah, that's great. Gosh, really good ideas. Well, thank you very much for sharing some time with us today and for this interview. And I really appreciate it and getting some insights from a world-class thinker and investor in these spaces. It's going to be really helpful to get your insights to this. So thank you so much.
Thanks for inviting me on, John. Good to see you.
Thank you. Take care.